Back when I was a child, before life removed all the innocence,
there are some things that a 5-year-old can read well. The back of a cereal box is one. The back of a broken man in a green Toyota Tercel is another. You don't know a man until you've watched him turn Luther Vandross into worship on the 95. My dad can sing Dance with My Father like an incantation. His tongue, almost a shovel to unbury the only man I've ever seen him cry over. My father is tough. Must be the way life prepares you when you've been in the fire for so long. He's strong, silent, and all backbone. So when he tells me he's the last survivor of his first family, my stomach origamis in a way I can't unfold. When he tells me it is cancer, I have to fist my jaw from the back of my throat. But I've barely seen him cry. Barely seen him hurt the way a man should hurt when he's lost his first family. My dad, a Stonehenge, until that song comes on, the music always turns him into a son again. I can almost see a grandfather I've never known in his two-step. Can almost see a father I've never known in his lightness. It's like we're sitting, flipping through an old photo album, nostalgia nested in the shaky bass. My dad would say this was his favorite song. But it never felt like a song. He didn't dance to this the way he did the Spanish ballads on the staticky stations. This one had wheels. One's not unlike the Tercel. This one made him move. Infected him. Sung like a symbiote, sometimes made me afraid too. That there would be a day where it would become my favorite song. The days where I try to drown out my feelings and catch them spilling out instead. It's what a song does, I guess. Reminds you of what you've lost. Or reminds you to hold on to it before you do.
What's happening, y'all? What's up, Piano Slam 14? Are you excited? Hold up, okay. So I can't hear you, right? But I still want y'all to feel this energy, right? And I want you to give me the energy right back, right? So if you're excited about Piano Slam, wherever you are, if you're at home, if you're at school, if you're at the grocery store, I don't care, get hype, all right? Now, if you're not hype right now, it can only be one reason. You don't know what I'm talking about, all right? And that's okay, because I'm here to let you know what's going on. So welcome, those who know and those who don't know, to Piano Slam 14 in partnership with the Adrian Arts Center. Now, what is Piano Slam? Piano Slam is all about music, and I mean everything music, right? From the beats, to the melody, to the lyrics, to the spirit of the song, all of it, right? It's about the music in your life, all right? So that could mean the music that you experience in your school life, or the music you experience when you eat your favorite food, or maybe it's like what I wrote, right? The music of the life of others around you, like your grandfather or your father. You know, it's anything. People you like, people you don't like, you know? It's just about talking about your world and using musical terms to do it, all right? Easy enough? Cool. So every year, Piano Slam brings a piece of music to you that drawn off two commissions that they'd like you to hear. This year, it's Fantasia de Tres Mundos by Martin Bejarano. And this composer works in three worlds: jazz, classical, and Afro-Cuban. All right, remember that. That's gonna be important. It's coming back later, so stick with me. You with me? So Piano Slam is a poetry competition that's about music, music's influence, musical language, all that. And there's a writing theme that allows you to think about how music is present and affects different parts of our world, all right? It's easy, it's all about music, like I said. Just keep that in your mind, music, all right? And here's where the three comes in. So just like Martin, we have three themes. It's your home, right? It's music, again, music, and humanness, right? Those are the things that you're gonna be writing about. Now, there's also three sets of rules, all right? One, your poetry must conform to whatever rules your school gives you, easy enough. Two, your poems have to be about music, your feelings about music, or contain musical language. So like I said, like beat and note and melody, whatever, right? There's a lot. And you know, I don't want you to just think like
you can think outside the box. So, you know, it doesn't just have to be crescendo and decrescendo and all of that. Open your world up to all of the language that music offers you, right? Because there's a lot. So, you with me? Now, that was two rules, right? I said there's a third. Now, this one's really important, all right? Stick with me. You must submit your poem by March 4th to pianoslam.org. That's pianoslam.org. Got that right? Yeah, I got that right. All right? You have to, right? Because how else are you going to be part of this if you don't submit it? All right? So, super easy. Now, I told you that I want to bring the energy and I want y'all to bring the energy back. So, now that you know everything about Piano Slam, are y'all excited for Piano Slam 14? Hold on. I feel like I felt the energy. One more time. Make some noise if you're excited. Oh, okay. All right. So let's get into it. For our first lesson, we're going to talk about a couple of things. One, what is music? Two, how does music, culture, our heritage, and growing up in Miami make us human? And three, what is poetry? And how in the world are we gonna get these words about music onto that page? Let's get into it.
Woo! And donde? Pa donde? Dale, da. Aquí lo malo no te alcanza. Vacila con confianza. Coge un party pa' tu masa. Que ando esperando el momento en que salga tu flow perfecto. Voy a presionar el botón pa' ponerte presión. Pa' meterte en mi película de ciencia ficción. Pa' que seas la heroína de mi vida y me saques del drama todos los días.
Dale, rompelo.
Mueve tu cuerpo en el piso de una manera intelectual.
Rompelo.
Aquí todo el mundo es lo suyo. No te me vayas a complejar.
Rompelo.
Hoy terminamos temprano en la mañana.
Rompelo.
La madrugada es tuya, haz lo que te dé la gana.
Hey you. Yes you. I need to tell you something. You see, music is a movement of melodies, a hymn of sensitivity and creativity, a forte of aggressivity, a quiet sound full of underactivity, the simple story of me. Like music, I can be sad. Melancholy is what my heart feels, just like a lonely bow without its fiddle, irrationally acting fitful without its tune. My hidden feelings flying in the atmosphere. It's what I most fear. Sometimes I want to disappear, but instead I cry a rhythm of tears. The sad part of me. Like music, I can be happy. Woo! A joyful choir in my life. Crescendo, but never decrescendo. Nothing but good memories. Never no need to worry of enemies. Life is a rising centerpiece, the happy part of me. Like music, I can be angry, mind crowded with worries, anger, anxiety, no orchestra can compare. Ugh, I couldn't possibly bear. Sometimes life isn't fair. Everything is full of questionnaires, but I receive no answer. Is that the reason of my despair? The angry part of me. Like music, I can be creative and free, weightless like fingers, lifting after hitting the piano keys, beautifully creating a masterpiece. Some may call it poetry, like how me, my reasons, and thesis define the greatest part of me. But like music, I am precious and true, sweet like harmony, full of endless elegy, here to share my story, my chords of legacy. Music defines me, a hymn of my complicated story, but listen here, it's worth the here, the dynamic coda of me.
Hi, my name is Katie Christie, and I'm this year's director of Piano Slam. I grew up here in Miami studying to be an artist, a performer. I studied music and singing and dance and theater, and I wanted to be on Broadway. And when I was in high school at New World, before my senior year, I was looking for something to do in the summer, and my mother discovered this program when we performed a play called Peace Child about, you know, world peace. And it was at that time that I realized, when I was performing to audiences that didn't speak English as I'm singing songs in English, that there was something really powerful about the arts and about music, and that people could really understand what was coming from my heart and my soul, even if they didn't understand the words that I was singing. And I realized that there was something more I could do with my art than just be a performer. I came home and I decided to start a local organization that was similar, that was gonna gather young people together to write plays about the things that concern them in their communities and in their world, and then, and hopefully inspire change. So what inspired me to create this organization when I was in high school, you know? And one of the things that I wanna talk with you all about is humanness. And I really think that it was this first trip that I took where I really started to understand what that meant for the first time. You know, when I was preparing for this trip, I was sat down by a lot of people and said, you know, when you get there, this is a really serious country. I want you to be prepared. People are gonna be dressed in all black and no one's gonna smile. People are not happy there. And, you know, it's gonna be a really difficult experience, you know? And when I went there, I realized that all of that was completely wrong, you know? And these people were exactly like us, you know? They sat down and had family dinner just like we do here in America. They would go to the park on Sunday and have a picnic and laugh and play and tag and chase their kids and tickle and stuff like that, just like we do here. And I realized that there was something that no matter where you were, it seemed like, you know, there's something really the same about us as human beings. And that there's that thing is the something that really connects us, you know? It doesn't matter what language we're speaking, but all of us share this like common need to be connected to other people, to be connected to each other, to share, to laugh, to love, to share memories with people, right? All of those things are what make us the same and human, you know? But then there's this even deeper concept of humanness, you know? And I like to think about that as like, you know, your inner humanity, you know, more than just that we are human beings and we have so many things about us that are the same, more things about us that are the same than the things that are different, right? But that inner humanity is that part of us that is like in our soul and in our spirit. And this is the way I think about it, right? And it's that part of us that wants good things for other people, right? That cares for other people without having to consider whether or not that's good for you too, right? That this idea that we're all making the world a better place together. So through my work, I've had the opportunity to travel to a bunch of different countries and sort of test out my hypothesis that the people are the same no matter where you are. So I've traveled to Japan, to South Africa, to Turkey, and more places. But most recently, I've been to Lesotho, which is a small country inside of South Africa. And the thing that I love very much about this country is how much it still operates like it it did for years and years and years and years in the past, right? And so going to Lesotho, while it has a city, once you leave the city, you're getting this window into what life was like maybe thousands and thousands of years ago, because people are still living the way they always lived. I talk to people there and I learn that, you know, there's this very common principle, like, it's okay if I don't have food. My neighbor has food, he'll share with me. When my neighbor doesn't have food, I will share with him. And we all work together. And I'm like, oh, so that's where this "it takes a village" comes from, right? And then I talk with people more and more, and I learn that there's this ancient African philosophy called Ubuntu, which loosely translated means, I am because we are, right? And so I've really found it refreshing and inspiring and healing to be able to be on the lands in Lesotho and with people who really practice a very ancient form of humanness that I'm hoping, you know, I can share with more people, because I do believe that it is a time, a really great time now, to connect more deeply to that. And thinking about, you know, humanness again, I think about growing up in Miami and really feeling lucky to live here, because I think that, you know, in Miami, where you can really see our humanity or that humanness is in our music, is in the arts. Miami is also unique in how the arts community is so very interconnected. It's always been a joy for me to find how often my path crosses with people that I grew up with in the arts, and get to collaborate with them. Getting to work with Martin Bejarano again is a great joy. Getting to work with Terrell Alva McCraney and so many more. It's not that unusual. There's something about our community that even if people have moved on and live in different places, there seems to be this desire to come back and collaborate here, or even elsewhere. But there's this draw, and I feel really lucky. There will always be continued opportunities for me to reconnect with artists that I've really enjoyed meeting and working with as a young person and as a young adult and as a middle-aged adult and again and again and again.
Se transforma su un tiempo no lejano, cuando tú me decías que jamás me olvidaría, y no, cuando tú me decías que sin mí no viviría, que yo siempre sería el amor de toda tu vida. No puedo imaginar que llegaría este día en que con tu despedida todo en mí lo trucaría, y no puedo imaginar que algún día tú te irías, pues siempre me decías que sin mí no viviría.
Hi, my name is Pablo Medina. I'm a poet, novelist,
translator and essayist. I was born in the city of Havana and spoke Spanish for the first 12 years of my life. Then English became increasingly my dominant and primary language, though I still retain much of that which began to make me special, special in the sense of being different, and that was Spanish. I grew up in a very, very musical home. We listened to music all the time. From the radio during the day, Cuban popular music, sones and boleros, and also popular music from all over Latin America. Tangos, rancheras from Mexico. So this was a music that surrounded me all the time. At night, when my father came home from work, I would listen to the music he played on his record player, which was classical. So I listened to classical music and learned to enjoy that, learned to like Beethoven, Mozart, Bach especially, and all the great classical composers. As I grew up and became an adolescent, I became very interested in jazz. So those were the three modes of music that I listened to. Of course, there was rock as well. Rock was very popular, and folk music. There was music everywhere, and I had a great love of it. My sister and I would often play the popular songs of the time on the guitar with each other. Not very well, I must say. She eventually became a very good musician, but I certainly didn't. I moved toward poetry. But poetry is a kind of music. Language has its own music, its own rhythms, and that was what I paid attention to primarily. That and the ability to connect with my own sense of what it meant to be human, how it was that I reached other people. I want to read a poem now, which is about my uncle Carlos. It's full of what I learned about what it means to make the best of circumstances. You know, it brings me back to what is home for me. Home is not necessarily a place, but rather a space that I make in my head, where all these characters that I knew as a child and I was growing up, and even as an adult, make their way and become alive again, as my uncle did in this poem. And as I read it, maybe you can listen to the music of the poem, the music of speech that I've sort of tried to capture here. Canticle of Uncle Carlos, who sat with a quart bottle of cheap beer under the mango tree after laying cinder blocks in the Miami heat all day, and proclaimed to his cousin Paco, "I feel like a king." This poem is for him, who always felt that way, even when he was dying of throat cancer and could barely speak through the tumor that was choking him. Still, he told dirty jokes to fellow patients in the common room and drank a beer I sneaked in past the nurse's station. My father called me with the news, almost crying. His brother had died. And now the tree was dying too. A mere coincidence, no doubt. No doubt we die miserably and alone in a nursing home with a radio playing a bolero of lost love the nurses like. Uncle Carlos never took things seriously, not money or power, not prestige or good looks or bad boleros. "Viva la muerte," he said. All he ever needed was a drink after a hard work day, the sun shining through the branches, and his cousin Paco, now dead as well, who marveled at the king on his throne under the mango tree. Music is in this poem. I mean, when I chose this poem to read, I hadn't thought of it, but there is a reference to the boleros that the nurses play on the radio, and it sort of took me back to when I would hear the boleros during the day as the family cleaned and cooked and prepared dinner and so on. But the poem, of course, is about my uncle and the way that he dealt with life, which was in a very cheery, hopeful way, even when he became sick and passed away. It's not really a tragic poem because it's full of what I learned about what it means to make the best of circumstances. In his case, working as a cinder block layer in Miami, a very hard job, but he always found a way of kind of redeeming the day by coming home and sitting under that mango tree. I still remember very clearly. I thank you for inviting me, and I wish you all well. I think it's a very exciting project, this piano slam, and I'm very happy to share my ideas with you. Thank you very much.
My name is Terrell Alvin McCraney. I grew up in Miami, Florida, Liberty City, and I graduated from New World School of the Arts in theater. Today we're going to be talking about the presence of now in poetry, in music, and how it comes forward. For me, I grew up in Liberty City, which is about 10 minutes away from here, and everywhere there is music. The street corners, in your house, in your school, on your bus. And that music transformed me, or called to me, to somehow try to put it down on the page. And that's always that hard transition, right? For a poet, for many of us who are poets, trying to find how to get those beats, those arpeggios, those accidental notes, and write them down as words. And so I look a lot to the classics. I go back to, say, the King James Bible. For the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me lie down in green pastures. What does that word mean, green pastures? And why does that elicit such a time of peace and quiet? How do you take a word and put them together and elicit a long passage of field or a sunlight or a beam of moon? And sometimes I go to Shakespeare, whose percussive rhythm reminds me of the heartbeat. How all occasions do inform against me and spur my dull revenge. The beats in that language, this shall pass, the length and the color, is how I find ways to take something as similar as rap music or samba and allow it to generate life on the page. Now, I know it all sounds like hocus pocus right now. It sounds as if I'm making up some magic trick. But in truth, I'm not. In truth, it is simply listening to any rhythm, the rhythm of the gumbe that used to happen in Coconut Grove, where my grandmother is from, or the rhythm of a car radio, the rhythm of a woman who I just passed who asked me for a dollar. Hey, nephew, what does that sound like? What does that beat? What is her calling across the street mean? And how do I put that down on the page? One of my favorite poems from my favorite poet, I found actually in the Miami-Dade Library, which is right down the street. One day I just walked in and I was looking for a poet who happened to speak about the gay black experience. And this poet, Essex Hemphill, wrote a poem called Heavy Breathing. At the end of heavy breathing, at the beginning of grief and terror, on the X2, a bus I like to call a slave ship, the majority of its riders black, pressing to journey northeast into voodoo ghettos, festering on the knuckles of the Negro dream. All of those sounds colluding in his head to make something from a bus ride. I ride the jitney a lot when I'm home, when I'm in Miami. I know some of you don't want to talk about riding the jitney, but I do. And when I'm on the jitney, I hear a myriad of sounds. There are people talking back and forth to each other in languages I don't understand, Spanish, Haitian, Creole. And there's also the music of the bus itself, the roar of the tires, yeah, the screeching of the halts, the whirring in and out of different neighborhoods. And then there is sometimes singing, women humming to themselves, babies crying, the sounds of phones going off. What does that music, that cacophony, do to one? How did Essex, on his bus, the X2, find a minute to call something heavy breathing? How did he hear heavy breath underneath all of that sound? So my invitation to you, to other writers, to those of you who like writing and poetry, those of you who are musicians and want to find ways to talk in different languages other than music, I invite you to listen to those sounds, all of them, bring them in and find where there's heavy breathing. Find how to speak about that heavy breathing underneath all of that and how to do it right now.
This party till it ends. You're in the house with the two live crew, and I'm gonna rock the mic for you. Our style is different from anyone else. Don't take my word, judge for yourself. There's three in the crew, that's all we need. We use a rap, they don't need to read. We got Mr. Mix and two MCs, so listen to the rap from the kid. ICE, baby, 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 baby. Say, listen, party people, to what I have to say. I put it in the rap, and it goes this way. By the type of girl I really like, the one I wish would spend the night.